Hi, my name is Scott Phillips. I'm the president and CEO of StarFish Medical. In this video, we're highlighting some interesting aspects of quality and regulatory. As you know, in medical devices, it's one of the areas that really distinguishes our sector from many others, the depth of knowledge that you need to be able to comply with the various regulations. But we've always seen that as a big asset because the regulations, if implemented well, actually can allow you to distinguish yourselves from other companies and avoid a lot of mistakes. In this video, you'll get to hear perspectives on, for example, the importance of internal auditing and project auditing to avoid later mistakes and unnecessary costs. I will also be presenting on some regulatory strategies and some reimbursement strategy. And finally, some perspectives on tips for medical device labeling. I hope you really enjoy the video. Thank you.
My name is Tara Lysechko. I'm a Senior Quality Assurance Regulatory Affairs Specialist at StarFish. Today, there's over 2 million different types of devices on the world market. And every device is different, and to complicate matters, each market has its own set of regulatory requirements. Developing a regulatory strategy as early as possible in device development is key to ensuring that your design decisions comply with applicable regulatory requirements, thus avoiding costly and time-consuming corrective efforts at later stages. This includes defining the intended use of the device, which forms a core part of the design history file, and also forms the basis for classification of the product in the target market. Regulatory requirements also inform the choice of materials and the extent of verification testing, so it's imperative that these regulatory requirements be identified early on. At StarFish, we have clients who come to us with well-defined regulatory strategies and those that need help to establish a strategy by evaluating different pathways to market. For example, for one of our clients, we presented three different options for a pathway in their target market. We provided the pros and the cons for each of these pathways, including factors such as intellectual property, the amount of clinical data that was required, the complexity of the submission, and the submission review times. This really helped the client make an informed decision based on their business needs. We also helped another client who was on a 510K pathway to identify two devices that could be used as a potential predicate early in device development. As development progressed, we helped them identify a third candidate that was even better suited to the product. To further help support the regulatory strategy, we connected the client with the regulatory consultant that helped to clear the device to give them that extra expertise in the product area. In addition, we identified that the product class was eligible for third-party review. We suggested that the client take that route as opposed to traditional review by FDA in order to speed up the review process.
Hi, my name is Deborah Pinchev and I'm the QARA manager out of the Toronto office. And today I'd like to talk about medical device labels. So labeling, it's one of the most important aspects of a medical device from the perspective of regulators such as the FDA. Labels provide key information to users, including communicating any safety concerns. Labels can include things like, you know, physical labels, markings on the device itself or its packaging. Also, any separate instructional material like the instructions for use, which can be hard copy or provided online. Also for software, information provided via the graphical user interface is also considered labeling. The content of your labels varies depending on where you market your device. The FDA, Health Canada, and the EU all contain minimal labeling requirements within their regulations. But beyond that, there are other important sources of labeling content that we should consider. Residual risks that are a result of the risk assessment drive labeling content. For example, if your risk analysis contains risks such as, let's say, cross-contamination of biological matter, you know, between the uses of the device, then your labeling will need to communicate this risk and provide instructions for cleaning in between uses. If your device contains electronics, then you need to meet 6601. Your labeling also needs to meet 6601-1 and any applicable collateral or particular standards. Each of these standards, they have a section for labeling and instructions for use. If you're developing an electrocardiograph, let's say, for example, it needs to meet 6601-2-25, and your device has attachable lead wires, then these wires need to be permanently marked with identifiers, as specified per that standard.
Hi, my name is Taimoor. I work at StarFish Medical in QA. I'm here to talk about auditing, which is an integral part of it for a medical device's development. It can be a difficult and critical process, and may not be something you want to hear, but they point out potential gaps and can offer opportunities for improvement as well. If you approach this from a constructive standpoint, you can greatly benefit from one. And after all, it's always great in your best interest to have an outsider's opinion about a process. Here at StarFish, we regularly audit our internal processes as part of our goals to continue to improve ourselves. We also offer external audits to our clients who are preparing for their product submissions to regulatory bodies such as Health Canada, the FDA, and European jurisdictions. And this past year, a client found themselves in this exact position. The client had a new QMS, quality management system, and were scheduled to be audited by the FDA. They reached out to us to get a different perspective. We were swiftly able to come up with an audit plan and were able to audit them against ISO 13485 and 21 CFR 820 through a 3-day virtual audit. And we looked top to bottom, from upper management responsibility, their quality policy, all the way down to their finished output. At the end, we presented the client with a report that with findings that we found would benefit them in a constructive way and would enable them to succeed with their inspection. And overall, you should embrace auditing. It might be scary to have an outsider perspective find potential holes in your hard work, but at the end of the day, you'll have a much better result.
Hi, I'm Alexandra Reid. I'm a QARA specialist at StarFish Medical, and today I'm going to talk a little bit about reimbursement strategy. So reimbursement is a complicated space. You really need to understand how it works because this can make or break your product success in the market. So what you need to think about when you're going into the reimbursement strategy is identifying a payer to get coverage for your device. And the reason for this is if it's not covered, the doctors and hospitals are not going to buy your product, patients aren't going to be able to afford it, and it doesn't matter how great your product is if nobody can use it. So one of our devices out there on the market fell into this trap. It was targeting a single reimbursement for joint surgery, and the idea is that they had a business model where they thought getting better coverage for advanced rehab would be better than having the redos of the joint surgery. Unfortunately, they fell short, and the ratio of fee-for-service versus the single payment was still too high in the US market, and they failed to get a successful market adoption that way. However, on the flip side, the heart valve industry shifted from $5,000 surgical valves to a more expensive $30,000 catheter valve system. And this was based on getting a larger share of surgical reimbursement, which was based on larger savings from the hospitals. So you have to be strategic in how you target your payers and what they'll be willing to cover. So when you're thinking of reimbursement strategies, the two things you want to keep in mind are, first, is there a code available for your new product? Or do you have to make a new code? And that's going to take a bit longer to convince the payers. Secondly, you want to really have your product demonstrate medical benefit, the added value it's going to bring, and this is going to be based on real-world outcomes, clinical evidence from successful patient outcomes. So if you keep this in mind, you can have a very targeted approach. One of our clients decided to not go with their competitors after Medicare, and instead they went after Veterans Affairs, and so they had a very niche system for reimbursement that way. So this is one way that you can be thinking outside the box when you're looking at reimbursement. So here at StarFish, we can assist with the regulatory approach, and you want to think of it as three legs of a stool. You want to have regulatory strategy in place, you want to have your marketing strategy in place, and you want to have your reimbursement strategy. And these all three need to work together.
If you'd like to know more about StarFish, we've been doing this for 20 years. We've developed hundreds of devices for companies all over the industry, and we've helped many founders become very successful and have big clinical impacts. That's what we really live for. So enjoy the content. If you'd like to talk to us about your project, we'd be happy to talk. Thank you.